Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Leadership Moments from NASA, Achieving the Impossible, by Dr. Dave Williams and Elizabeth Howell, Ph.D., narrated by Matthew Josdal. Introduction. Houston, Tranquility Base, the Eagle has landed. July 20th, 1969. A day that will stand forever in history. With the advent of television, more people were watching the NASA lunar landing than any other event in history. It had been 8 years since President John F. Kennedy proclaimed that NASA would send humans to the moon and return them safely to Earth before the end of the decade. Not because it is easy, but because it is hard. With that proclamation began one of the most incredible stories of leadership, teamwork, and risk management in history. It takes courage and a relentless commitment to excellence to achieve the impossible. Even with today's space exploration capabilities, many wonder how NASA was able to accomplish this seemingly impossible feat, successfully achieving Kennedy's goal within the decade. It wasn't easy. Many who dreamed of exploring space believed that it would be impossible. The televised Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo missions, and the many articles in Life and National Geographic magazines, captured the imaginations of the young and old. It was clear that there were risks associated with space exploration. To push the boundaries of the unknown was not something to be taken lightly. In January 1967, the crew of Apollo 1 perished. Not in space, but on the launch pad, in a fire lasting 90 seconds. The crew trapped inside the Apollo capsule had no chance for survival, and NASA suffered the first loss of a spaceflight crew. When asked about risk in December 1966, Commander Gus Grissom responded, "You sort of have to put that out of your mind. There's always a possibility that you can have a catastrophic failure, of course. This can happen on any flight. It can happen on the last one, as well as the first one. So you just plan as best you can to take care of all these eventualities, and you get a well-trained crew, and you go fly." A month later, he, Roger Chaffee, and Ed White would perish in the tragic fire. Space exploration is the story of people working together through triumph and tragedy. Gene Kranz, now famous as the lead flight director during Apollo 13, responded to the Apollo 1 fire by calling a meeting of his staff in Mission Control 3 days after the accident. Not mincing words, he said, "We were too gung-ho about the schedule, and we blocked out all of the problems we saw each day in our work. Every element of the program was in trouble, and so were we." With a steely gaze and short crew cut, Kranz, an aerospace engineer and former fighter pilot, embodied the NASA culture. From this day forward, flight control will be known by two words, tough and competent, he said, looking each team member in the eye. Tough means we are forever accountable for what we do or what we fail to do. We will never again compromise our responsibilities. Competent means we will never take anything for granted. Mission control will be perfect. When you leave this meeting today, you will go to your office, and the first thing you will do there is to write tough and competent on your blackboards. It will never be erased. Each day when you enter the room, these words will remind you of the price paid by Grissom, White, and Chaffee. These words are the price of admission to the ranks of Mission Control. The team left the meeting and refocused their efforts on one of the most significant achievements in history, sending humans to the moon. Galvanized in front of their televisions, 650 million viewers worldwide watched as the crew of Apollo 11 undocked the Lunar Module, LM, from the Command Service Module, CSM, as Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin began their descent to the lunar surface. Quiet and unassuming, Neil Armstrong had already developed a reputation for his humility and his performance under stress. His recovery of an out-of-control spacecraft caused by a stuck thruster on Gemini 8, and his understated reaction to ejecting from the flying bedstead when it started to plummet out of control a few hundred feet in the air, had already given him legendary status in the astronaut office. Now, the next 3 hours would determine if he and Buzz Aldrin would become the first humans to land on the surface of the moon. "You are go for undocking," the Capcom or capsule communicator said. The LM slowly began moving away from the CSM, leaving Michael Collins alone to contemplate his fate should his colleagues not return from the lunar surface. "Roger, understand," Aldrin responded. Armstrong, clearly in control of the situation, informed Mission Control, "The Eagle has wings." As the altitude of the lunar module decreased towards the surface of the moon, an alarm sounded harshly over the loop. "It's a 1202, Armstrong said, reporting the alarm before asking, "Give us a reading on the 1202. Guidance Officer Steve Bales called standby flight to Flight Controller Gene Kranz. The 1202 alarm indicated a problem with the LM onboard computers. Computers that were guiding the first humans to the lunar surface. Even today, computers have limitations of memory and speed. Modern cell phones have much greater capability than the computers on board the Apollo LM, yet everyone understands the problems associated with running out of memory or trying to use applications that demand more from a processor than it is able to give. Kranz recalled that moment. It is like coming to a fork in the road where you're uncertain which direction to take. One can only imagine what Neil, Buzz, and Mike were thinking as the descent continued under the guidance of the computer. Indeed, some may wonder whether it would have been more prudent to abort the attempted landing and figure out what was going on with the computer. Within 30 seconds, which seemed like a lifetime to the team in Mission Control and the astronauts orbiting the moon, Bales responded, "We're go on that alarm flight." There was no pause, no doubt, no questions asking, "Are you sure?" from the flight director, the team in Mission Control, or the astronauts. Rather, the quick response was accepted and trusted by everyone. Where did that trust come from? Why would the astronauts, the flight director, and Mission Control team not question the call? There is only one word which can be used to adequately describe why everyone continued with the landing. Competency. The flight control team were living in the Gene Kranz credo of tough and competent. In the hundreds of hours of simulation in preparation for the lunar landing, Gene Kranz had demanded that everyone bring their best. It was a commitment to excellence and unrelenting competency from each member of the Mission Control team. His leadership paid off. Duke said over the loop, "It's the same one we had in training." The rigorous simulations had prepared them. They were ready. No one questioned the call. Everyone embodied tough and competent to ensure that this was the day that NASA would achieve the seemingly impossible goal of landing humans on the moon and returning them safely to Earth within 9 years of flying the first humans in space. The alarm was the first test of the team. Shortly after receiving the go for landing call from Mission Control, there was a new 1201 alarm. The memory and performance of the computer were overtasked, managing all of the data and calculations necessary to successfully land on the lunar surface. The response remained the same. "We're go flight." This decision was made with the confidence that comes from having learned from a similar situation during training. As the tension in Mission Control began to rise with the frequency of the alarms, Another, more critical problem emerged that might result in disaster, in complete mission failure, with the LM crash landing on a lunar terrain too rocky and cratered for a safe landing. To avoid catastrophe, the landing would have to be extended. Armstrong calmly took over manual control of the LM, and with the hopes of millions riding on his skill, he began to extend the landing towards safety. As the LM continued to descend, the astronauts, as well as the team in mission control, tracked the fuel remaining with a vigilance linked to the knowledge that if they ran out of fuel, they would crash on the lunar surface. The crash site would be a permanent reminder for the rest of eternity that the first attempt to land humans on the moon had failed. The commander's window of the LM remained filled with images of a rocky, cratered lunar surface, unfit for landing. Everyone was beginning to think that the landing attempt should be aborted. Everyone except Neil Armstrong, who was now manually guiding the LM on a trajectory to a safe landing site he could see in the distance, past the craters below. Hand-flying a spacecraft known for its instability, one of the best pilots in the astronaut office took control to once again save the day. While the LM represented the pinnacle of technology of the decade, it was a human hand that would determine if the landing would occur safely on the lunar surface. Neil continued to extend the landing trajectory. The call low level was made on the flight director's loop, indicating 2 minutes of fuel remaining. Buzz was shifting his attention from calling out the altitude and forward motion of the landing module to assessing the remaining fuel quantity, to watch in awe as Neil continued the landing. In the distance, a flat area suitable for landing emerged on the lunar surface. Duke reported the amount of fuel remaining to the crew, 60 seconds, in a calm but terse voice. For the millions of viewers watching, it was hard to understand the drama that was unfolding in mission control. Aldrin continued his verbal reports of the LM's descent profile. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. Good. The fuel was rapidly diminishing. Neil continued to extend the landing, holding the ungainly LM in its landing profile, trying to conserve fuel in his attempt to land successfully. The abort switch, an ever-present opportunity to survive, but also to fail, loomed in front of the crew. 40 feet, down 2.5. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Faint shadow, Aldrin's calls continued as the LM descended, kicking up dust from the only available landing site in the area. Contact. There was a brief period of silence, followed by the words, "Houston, the Eagle has landed." They did it. The crew of Apollo 11 and the team in mission control had overcome adversity and achieved the impossible. With an emotion-filled voice, Duke congratulated the crew. "Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot." With smiles and cheers resounding in mission control, handshakes were being traded, photographs taken. This was history in the making. In the final stages of landing, no one knew if the remaining seconds would end in disaster or in success. The odds were huge. The stress defied description. The illumination of the contact light defined the moment. The blink of a light bulb confirmed success. They had done it. Gene, beaming at the team, reminded them that the mission wasn't over. It was time to get back on the consoles, to help the crew get ready for the first lunar spacewalk in history, and later, the moment everyone dreaded, lift off from the lunar surface to return the crew to lunar orbit and rendezvous with the command module. But for one brief instant that would remain frozen in time in the minds of that remarkable team, they had achieved the impossible. The story of Apollo 11 is the story of teamwork, of leadership, of courage and commitment. It is a story based on a culture undaunted by the challenges of space exploration. It is a story we can all learn from. Ultimately, it defined the NASA culture. A culture that was forged on the experiences of courageous astronauts, engineers, mission controllers, and leaders who managed incredible risks to achieve success. It is a story of passion, of excellence, of resilience and learning. It created a legacy that would carry forward through the Skylab space station missions and the Apollo-Soyuz collaborative mission of the next decade, into the era of the space shuttle and the International Space Station. There have been many leadership moments in NASA's history, and every such moment provides a story that can apply to each of us. Whether we are growing as leaders trying to manage the many challenges of working together in organizations large or small, or whether we are interested in learning how to work together on peak-performing teams, the lessons from space are as relevant on Earth today as they have been in the past. Anything worth doing is typically difficult, frequently requiring teams to manage complex challenges to make data-driven decisions that will achieve success. The NASA culture defies the limits of traditional leadership by creating peak-performing teams where each individual strives relentlessly to build their competency, to build trust, and to create strong links in a chain that binds the team together. There is an opportunity for all of us to learn from the experiences of the pioneers who began the conquest of space, the final frontier. Chapter 1: The Sound That Changed the World. Listen now for the sound that forevermore separates the old from the new. NBC Radio. Of all the sounds associated with the 20th century, it is surprising that a repetitive beep, beep on the radio would change the course of history. The beep was first heard Friday, October 4th, 1957, originating from the Russian Sputnik satellite that was launched at 10:29 p.m. Moscow time. Later that evening in North America, the first recordings of the distinctive sound from the satellite were heard. The CBS News special that covered the Sputnik launch and its impact opened with an 18-second recorded transmission of the beep, with anchor Douglas Edwards commenting, "That sound had never been heard on this earth." Suddenly, it has become as much a part of the 20th century life as the whirr of your vacuum cleaner. The sequence of a repetitive 300-millisecond tone, followed by an equal pause, was perceived as a challenge to U.S. technology and the Western way of life. It was a sound that changed the world forever. 7 years earlier, a number of space scientists had met in James Van Allen's living room to discuss opportunities for international collaboration in space research as a part of the first International Geophysical Year, IGY. A proposal was made to the International Council of Scientific Unions, and the announcement was made in 1952 to declare the period from July 1957 to December 1958 the IGY. In July 1955, the White House announced its intention to launch a satellite as one element of its national contribution to the IGY. The announcement was met with an immediate response by the Soviets, with scientist Leonid Sedov sharing his country's intention to launch a satellite in the near future at the 6th Congress of the International Astronautical Federation in Copenhagen, 4 days after the American announcement. The growing Cold War had set the stage for what would ultimately become the race for space. 2 months before White House Press Secretary James Hagerty announced the U.S. plans for the IGY, President Dwight Eisenhower approved a new space policy that included the launch of a scientific satellite, as well as a military program for the Army, Air Force, and Navy to develop launch vehicles. Between 1955 and the beginning of the IGY, there were essentially four different programs working to establish a U.S. presence in space, with little collaboration between them. The Soviets took a more pragmatic approach that focused on a unified program to combine military launch capabilities with the integration of scientific payloads. By January 1957, Eisenhower was becoming very concerned with the rising costs of the combined programs, which had grown from estimates of $20 million to $80 million. And he agreed to schedule the first launch attempt in October that year, using the Navy-led Vanguard Space Launch Vehicle to carry a small scientific satellite. At the same time, the Army launch capability was being developed by the Army's Ballistic Missile Agency, ABMA, under the leadership of Wernher von Braun, the head of the German rocket scientists brought to the U.S. after the war. While the Navy beat the Army in their 1957 football game, the Army's rocket program was far ahead of the Navy's Vanguard program. In September 1956, a year before Sputnik, the Army had successfully launched a suborbital multi-stage spacecraft that reached an altitude of 1,097 kilometers, 681 miles. The Jupiter C rocket could have carried a satellite, but the scientific mission for IGY had been allocated to the Navy Vanguard program. It was a missed opportunity. There had always been suspicion about allowing the former German rocket scientists to help the Army develop long-range guided missiles. The Army Redstone rocket flights started in 1952, and von Braun had a vision of attaching enough upper stages to boost a satellite into orbit. With the Redstone, we could do it. To launch a satellite, of course, von Braun said. The Germans were forbidden from doing so, but it didn't stop von Braun from dreaming about it. He embodied visionary leadership and widely shared ideas for rotating space stations to have astronauts working in artificial gravity and flights to the moon. He proposed the idea of a human mission to Mars. At the time, his ideas seemed like science fiction, but within decades, they would become scientific facts. The July 1957 start of the IGY brought with it the possibility of an imminent Russian launch. The administration recognized the possibility that the Soviets would use a successful launch as propaganda in the growing Cold War, and Eisenhower was increasingly frustrated by the lack of progress and the risk of falling behind the Soviet effort. He pushed the Navy program for the launch of the simplest possible satellite at the earliest date possible. As the summer progressed, the administration suspected a Soviet launch was imminent. However, they underestimated what a successful launch, a carefully planned announcement, and the effect of the ever-present beep from the satellite would mean to the rest of the world, the American public and media, who were all caught by surprise. Haggerty's comment at a press conference after the Sputnik launch that they never thought the U.S. program was in a race with the Soviets fell on deaf ears. 2 months later, the Navy Vanguard 1A satellite and spacecraft were ready for launch. The team had been demoralized by the Sputnik launch, but had quickly regrouped to get ready for the December 6th launch attempt. At 11:44 and 35 seconds a.m. Eastern Standard Time, the hopes of the team lifted with the roar of ignition. The vehicle rose roughly 4 feet in the air, the engine lost thrust, and the rocket failed to lift off, sinking back to explode on the launch pad. As if to add insult to injury, the nose cone detached, landing free of the rocket with the satellite still beeping. Given a second successful Soviet launch the previous month, The press were gratuitous with their criticism, regarding to the Vanguard failure as kaputnik, stayputnik, and flopnik. Failure is a true test of character. It is what you do when you don't succeed that determines if you will ultimately succeed. Undeterred by the criticism, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory and the ABMA launched the Explorer 1 satellite on January 31, 1958, at 10:48 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, as part of the U.S. participation in the IGY. The JPL satellite was equipped with scientific instrumentation that was used to detect the Van Allen radiation belt, and the ABMA had modified one of its Jupiter C rockets to carry the satellite to space. From a scientific perspective, the mission was an outstanding contribution to the IGY, but its achievements were overshadowed by the success of the Sputnik missions and the loss of the Vanguard spacecraft. Sputnik's beep, beep, beep signal lasted only 23 days, and it was destroyed re-entering the Earth's atmosphere less than 100 days after its launch. But its impact was far greater than the more important scientific discoveries of Explorer 1 satellite. No event since Pearl Harbor set off such repercussions in public life. Walter A. McDougall, historian. America in the late 1950s was a land of opportunity. The middle class was rapidly growing and was benefiting from new comforts, goods, and services, which were said to be a testimony to the benefits of a modern democracy and national strategic priorities. It was inconceivable that the U.S. had fallen behind in the quest for space. America had to respond, and respond it did. The Explorer satellite was the immediate response, but the Sputnik effect was so profound, it precipitated the creation of NASA, brought a new priority to scientific research and technology development, and set the stage for the upcoming decade of space exploration. Eisenhower and the National Space Council recognized the importance of coordinating the nation's space efforts into a lead agency that would be called the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA. Given the agency's mandate, it was a surprise to some that the first NASA administrator would be a university president with a background in the motion picture industry. The right leader. There is no specific formula for success as a leader. Perhaps that is why there are so many books, seminars, and courses dedicated to the topic. Leadership is based upon a breadth of skills that combine technical and behavioral competencies to influence large groups to achieve results. Eisenhower's science advisor Jim Killian felt that Thomas Keith Glennon, then president of the Case Institute for Technology in Ohio, would be a perfect fit for the role. Glennon recalled, "It was early August, I think, because the president signed that bill 29 July. I had a call from Jim. He said, 'Keith, I'd like you to come down to Washington as soon as you can get here. I want to talk with you about the possibility of your becoming involved here. It's possible that the president would like to see you.' Glennon responded, 'All right, Jim.' He arrived later that night and went to Killian's apartment. Killian showed him the bill creating NASA. After scanning it quickly, Glennon said, 'Well, it's fraught with difficulties, but I guess it could be made to work. What is it you want of me?' Killian said, 'I want you to be the first administrator.' Later, Glennon commented, 'I don't have any idea why my name was put in the nomination, except that Jim knew me. Not well, but we had been moving Case pretty well.'" Glennon had studied electrical engineering at Yale University. After graduation, he found himself in a series of leadership roles in the sound motion picture industry, and he subsequently became the director of the U.S. Navy Underwater Sound Laboratory, during World War II. After the war, he was an executive with the Ansco Corporation, prior to becoming the president of the Case Institute of Technology in Ohio. As is the case for many humble leaders, Glennon's comments to Killian about his achievements at the Case Institute were a significant understatement of the role he had played transforming the organization. Glennon had faced a number of challenges. We had a full plate trying to build or rebuild a new institution. Again, I'm not an academician. I never taught a class a day in my life. I was relying on people, trying to get good people, trying to raise the money to rebuild an institution. In Killian's mind, Glennon was a proven leader with a skill set that would be critical for the new NASA administrator. What is more important? It seems clear to me that we must find a way to exert leadership as we identify more clearly our own goals. By definition, our present practice of reacting to the Soviet actions must doom us to ultimate failure. Thomas Keith Glennon. The next day, Glennon met with Eisenhower. I don't think Jim went in with me, but he introduced me to Mr. Eisenhower. He sat me down, told me about the task that was ahead of us, asked me a few questions. I told him I didn't know a damned thing about which end of the rocket you lit. I'd been very busy putting my institution together, and he said, I think I want you to become the administrator. We want to move fast, so I hope you won't keep me waiting. Glennon said he would act as fast as he could with his other obligations. And it was on the 19th of August. I was sworn in. Glennon understood that assembling an experienced leadership team would be critical to succeed. He had been directed to incorporate the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, NACA, organization in its entirety into NASA. His first step was to convince Hugh Dryden, the technical director of the NACA, to become his deputy administrator. Glennon recalled the NACA team idolized Hugh Dryden. If we had not held on to Hugh, I don't think we would have had as rich a cooperation from the NACA people. Within months, he brought together the 8,000 NACA employees, with an annual budget of $100 million and three major research laboratories. The Langley Aeronautical Laboratory, Ames Aeronautical Laboratory, and the Lewis Flight Propulsion Laboratory to create the new space agency. Building capacity. Glennon's short-term strategy was to build NASA as a preeminent organization with the best engineers and scientists. His long-term strategy was to develop a program on our own terms, designed to allow us to progress sensibly toward the goal of ultimate leadership in this competition. Consolidating the nation's efforts in space exploration would be critical to success. Within months, Glennon incorporated several groups involved in space exploration from other federal agencies into NASA. He brought part of the Naval Research Laboratory into NASA, leading to the creation of the Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland. He incorporated several disparate satellite programs, along with the Air Force and Department of Defense's DOD, Advanced Research Projects Agency Research Program, which had been developing a million-pound thrust, single-chamber rocket engine. In December 1958, he brought JPL, a contractor facility operated by the California Institute of Technology, Caltech, in Pasadena, California, into NASA. The last critical strategic decision was to incorporate the ABMA into NASA to create the Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama. During Glennon's tenure as administrator, he rapidly built the agency's capacity and established a culture of trust within his senior team. Glennon recognized that he needed to focus on broader strategic issues and the relationship with the White House and administration, while Dryden dealt with the planning of Project Mercury and building the foundation for the human spaceflight program. Glennon also created the Space Task Group, with Robert R. Gilruth as its director, and added scientist Homer Newell to his team. The diverse backgrounds and different skills of the four leaders were critical to the success of the agency. To succeed in sending humans to space, NASA had to continue growing rapidly. Glennon recalled, "I didn't come into the government to add to the government payroll. In the 30 months I was there, we went from about 8,000 or 8,500 to 18,000 people, and only 1,600 of them were new hires. The rest were transfers from ABMA, JPL, NRL, Naval Research Laboratory, Army Signal Corps, and the rest. Developing the new spacecraft that would be used for Project Mercury meant rapidly deploying new technologies. The new engineers were critical, but more help was needed. NASA would need help from the private sector. Glennon set up a meeting with aerospace companies to highlight upcoming NASA programs and outlined a competitive request for proposal process that would be used for procurement. He established three independent committees, one to assess management, another to evaluate experience and task performance, while the last focused on technical capabilities. The people on one committee did not know who the other teams were. The recommendations of each of the teams were brought to Glennon and Dryden, and they chose the winning bid. For Glennon, safety was critical. There were many known and unknown risks that had to be managed, and he wanted to establish a process to control the expected and unexpected. He established quality control as a NASA priority at a time when statistical quality control was just beginning to be understood. He said, "When you're talking about Mercury and man-rated flights, I didn't think we could be too careful. We found a man. He was a statistical quality control person, and he knew his business. I gave him free rein. He could look at anything and require anything done to improve reliability, safety, if there were shortcomings in the manufacturing process or assembly process. He found them." Glennon recalled Gilruth coming up from Langley saying, "What are you doing to us? We don't need this guy. Our life has been made of being careful, being sure. Quality control is a way of life." Glennon responded, "Bob, I'm sorry. You're going to have to do it. I insist that there be an external quality control review on everything that we do." As a leader, Glennon understood the importance of senior leadership commitment in building processes to control risk into the NASA culture. Gilruth had been a NACA engineer his entire career, and as director of the Space Task Group, he understood Glennon's desire to get the best and brightest to work at the agency. Gilruth was relentless in his pursuit of talent. From its earliest days, NASA has been an organization that has attracted outstanding individuals. His quest brought him to Toronto, Canada. It turns out the same day that Sputnik launched, crowds were gathered at the Malton Airport in Toronto for the unveiling of the Avro Aircraft Limited supersonic CF-105 Aero. Avro engineer Owen Maynard recalled, "The exact day we rolled our Avro Aero out the hangar door for the press to see, there wasn't great media attention. We couldn't figure it out. We had no idea." Within months, the program was canceled, and a number of Canada's top aerospace engineers lost their jobs. To Gilruth, tasked with hiring talented engineers, the announcement was a huge opportunity. He recalled, "I got a call from a friend of mine in Canada who said that the Canadians had lost this big contract for building a fighter. they were going to have to get rid of their top people. Here we were in the space task group, just absolutely strapped for top people. It was a big break for us. The NASA team reviewed 400 applications from members of the Aero team that resulted in hiring 25 experienced aerospace engineers. By the summer of 1960, Glennon had built a secure foundation for NASA to succeed. It had become the primary agency for all space activities, with the exception of a few programs controlled by the Department of Defense. He left NASA in January 1961, a few months before Yuri Gagarin's first flight and Alan Shepard's historic first American spaceflight, to return to his previous position as president of the Case Institute for Technology. He continued in that role until 1966, helping to negotiate the merger of the Institute with Western Reserve University to create the Case Western Reserve University. Yet, it was in his role as the founding NASA administrator that he left his legacy by positioning NASA to succeed in the race to space. NASA was fortunate to have Glennon as its first administrator. NASA historian Roger Lonius described him as the perfect choice to lead the new organization, an engineer who had worked in government, industry, and academia. Glennon positioned NASA so that it could serve as a vehicle for competing against the Soviet Union in the developing space race. His proven track record as a leader enabled him to succeed. He knew what to do, and he did what needed to be done. He built a team that would go on to successfully land humans on the moon and established a NASA culture that was willing and able to tackle seemingly impossible challenges. Leadership insights. Trust can take years to build when starting from a position of distrust. If leaders are trusted to lead, their leadership should be trusted. Learn from the experiences of others. Consolidate where possible, and collaborate whenever possible to build capacity, efficiency, and expertise. Find the best. Hire the best. Train the best to be better, and let them do their job. Build a senior team with diverse but complementary skill sets, proven leadership expertise. Trust them, and listen to them. Chapter 2. Inventing the Future. The best way to predict the future is to invent it. Alan Kay. Building the capacity to safely send humans to space takes time and leadership. It was clear that the Soviet and American satellite launches were the beginning of a new era of spaceflight. The critical question was, how long would it take before humans were ready to travel in space? Shortly after the Sputnik launch, the famous Air Force pilot and NACA Main Committee Chair James H. Doolittle asked Guyford Stever, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, Associate Dean of Engineering, to lead a special committee to assess future needs for space technology. The committee was made up of many leading space experts, including Wernher von Braun, Hugh Dryden, Abe Silverstein, Bob Gilruth, and Dr. Randolph Lovelace, all of whom became notable for the key roles they would play in Project Mercury. Their report set the stage for human spaceflight, focusing the first missions to achieve the early successful flight of man, with all his capabilities, into space, and his safe return to Earth. When Glennon created the Man in Space Soonest program in January 1959, he designated Gilruth the director of Project Mercury. At that point, Gilruth had been leading Glennon's new Space Task Group, STG, for a few months. When asked about the choice of a name for his team, Gilruth said, "What we needed was a good name, and we didn't like to sound like we were too big for our britches. We were a task group. We had a big task, and we were a group. He had assembled a great team and a plan, but he and his team had to figure out what would be needed to send humans to space. The program required a human-rated rocket or launch vehicle, a spacecraft, astronauts, and some form of control center, most of which did not exist. They had to invent it. The team was made up of a number of outstanding NACA engineers, including George Lowe and Maxime Fagé. It was the beginning of a group of technical experts that would work together during the next decade to take humans to the moon. Lowe was a visionary willing to share his bold goals that would shape NASA's future. Gilruth immediately recognized Lowe's capabilities, noting, "He was good at everything. He was a top-notch engineer and scientist. He could handle people well. He was good with money matters, and he was very easy to get along with. He was an ideal administrator and friend, and a big help to us, especially in the days when we didn't have many people. He was worth about 10 men." The team worked extremely hard, putting in long hours to do what it took to come up with a plan for human spaceflight. Their report resulted in the creation of Project Mercury and a 3-year journey to launch the first American to space. When presented with the panel's findings, Glennon's response summarized the prevailing sentiment. Get the hell to work. Gilruth wanted Lowe to join the STG to work as the deputy to Chief Engineer Fagé on spacecraft design, to design the Mercury spacecraft. Unfortunately, the team would have to proceed without him. Silverstein also recognized Lowe's potential and asked him to come to NASA headquarters in Washington to help work on NASA's long-range plans. Silverstein's request would prove pivotal when Lowe testified before the Senate Aeronautical and Space Sciences Committee in support of the 1960 NASA proposed budget. Looking directly at the committee chair, Lyndon B. Johnson, Lowe spoke about the importance of funding space exploration to spur further technology development. Although Project Mercury constitutes a logical, and perhaps only the first step in our manned exploration of space, we are already studying more advanced systems. We will develop the capability of sending several men into orbit for longer periods of time than one day. We will then be in a position to conduct scientific experiments in a series of manned orbiting laboratories. Concurrently, we will make efforts to fly further away from Earth, perhaps to the vicinity of the moon. But a landing on the moon must await the development of boosters that are nearly 20 times as powerful as those that are available today. Ever the visionary, Lowe felt that sending humans to the moon would provide a goal beyond the Mercury program, drive the development of new technology, and provide the greatest national benefit from the huge cost and risk of human spaceflight. The plan for Apollo would come, but to fly to the moon, the NASA team first had to learn how humans lived and worked in space. Those lessons would come from Project Mercury. Create an environment of trust. Gilruth's immediate task was to ensure the STG had the capacity to do everything that needed to be done as quickly as possible. He clearly understood his team was expected to put humans in space first and bring them back in good shape before the Soviets did. To get ready for Mercury, the original 35-member STG would grow rapidly, ultimately including roughly 750 people by the end of 1961. The initial group included the Canadians Jim Chamberlain, Owen Maynard, and Tequan Roberts, who had worked together at Avro, along with Americans Chris Kraft, Glenn Lunny, Gene Kranz, and other experts who had worked together at the NACA. I never remember Bob Gilruth telling anybody what they should do, or how to do anything. He just talked with them long enough that they thought his idea was their idea, and they went and did it the way he wanted it. Kenneth Klangnecht. The work schedule was the most intense that Gilruth and his colleagues had ever experienced. Quiet by nature, Gilruth did not impose his ideas on the team. Rather, he would ask probing questions that challenged the team to think about a problem from a different perspective. He created an environment of trust that motivated the group to do their best. Dwayne Catterson, one of Gilruth's team, described him as an inspirational leader, a gentleman, somebody who just didn't have a mean bone in his body and yet commanded instant respect because he had such an all-encompassing knowledge of his field and what he was doing, and a great capacity to inspire confidence in the people around him. It would take all of Gilruth's leadership skills and the team's combined technical expertise to fly the first humans in space. Ironically, the first big challenge facing the former NACA engineers was the technical requirements of the Mercury spacecraft. An important yet mundane aspect of this process was how to write a request for proposal, or RFP, a standard step to solicit government contracts. "We'd never written an RFP in our lives," Kraft said. Gilruth had made him part of the core team, and his first assignment was to develop a plan for the mission. "We didn't know a damn about putting a man into space," Kraft said. "We had no idea how much it should or would cost. And at best, we were engineers trained to do things, not business experts trained to manage people." As Kraft juggled the challenge of developing standards for spaceflight, items such as flight plans, timelines, procedures, mission rules, communications networks, and contingency management, he found himself thrust into project management. Along with learning to write a government RFP, he was tasked with selecting the aerospace contractors that would work on the program. According to Kraft, the Langley Research Center group considered themselves the do-it-yourself experts of aeronautics. "When we needed something, we requisitioned it, bought it, or built it ourselves." That approach had to change. Current business leaders speak of organizational agility, which is the ability of an organization to respond, adapt, and change quickly to succeed in a rapidly changing, ambiguous environment. This agility was also essential during the origins of human spaceflight. The Mercury team knew that they needed to put an American into orbit around the world. Yet there were challenges in fulfilling that goal. They understood how to design the spacecraft capsule, but there was considerable uncertainty about the organizational and operational infrastructure needed to successfully send and return humans from space. Gilruth let others in NASA engage in the fiery debates that captured the attention of the public and journalists. But in the background, he was the one moving the pieces. Kraft said, he sat to one side, listened, absorbed, offered a quiet comment or a whispered observation, and not many even noticed that he was there. With Gilruth's leadership, the team figured it out in 3 short years. By early 1961, it looked like the Mercury program was perfectly poised to launch the first human to space. The new year started by bringing a cold front to Washington, D.C., that had dropped south from the Great Lakes, resulting in a huge snowstorm the day before newly elected President Kennedy's inauguration. It was dubbed the Kennedy Inaugural Snowstorm. New winds of change were blowing into NASA as well. Glennon returned to the Case Institute, and James Webb became the new administrator. The new president appointed Jerome Wiesner from MIT as the head of his science advisory committee, and Wiesner decided he was going to investigate the Man in Space program. The first astronaut had been selected, trained, and was primed for flight. but a fateful management decision let the Soviets take their place in history. Gilruth recalled Wisner's committee. "They came to investigate us, thought it, launching so soon, was a bad idea, and said we were going to have to make sure it was the proper thing for America to be doing. It was a very serious situation. We could have flown Al Shepard before the Soviet manned satellite." The committee's voice carried the day, despite Webb trying to battle the consensus with the White House. "I obviously appreciated his, Gilruth's, decision to let me make the first flight. But he never told me why he made that decision the way he did. I asked him several times over the years, and he always said, 'Well, you were just the right man at the right time. Alan Shepard.'" Unfortunately, the delays impacted Shepard's launch date, and Yuri Gagarin became the first human in space on April 12, 1961. Shepard launched only 23 days later, becoming the first American. Shepard's Freedom 7 Mercury flight captured the hearts of all Americans. Many had felt that the U.S. program was dead and out, but the response was overwhelmingly positive, with ticker tape parades and nationwide front page coverage. Although they were behind the Soviets, NASA was still in the game. Leadership insights. Relentlessly ask questions to clarify why and how things need to be done. If you know what to do, do it. If you don't know what to do, use the best available data and the opinions of trusted experts to make the best decision possible. Organizational agility is based on innovation, teamwork, judgment, skills, and knowledge. Build competency to build capacity. Chapter 3, Taking on the Impossible. The exploration of space will go ahead, whether we join in it or not. And no nation which expects to be the leader of other nations can expect to stay behind in the race for space. John F. Kennedy. How do you build on the success of a single mission in space? NASA knew that it was possible to bring humans into space. Alan Shepard had captured the heart of the nation with his 15-minute suborbital hop, a flight that didn't fully circle the Earth, on May 5, 1961. It was days later that President John F. Kennedy declared that the United States would land people on the moon before the end of the decade. Unlike President Eisenhower, Kennedy and his team embraced Lowe's recommendation from the previous year to expand the program and began funding a lunar landing mission. From that point, the pace at NASA escalated quickly. The U.S. had a grand total of 15 minutes of lived experience in space. Sure, the astronauts were able. They were former military test pilots. Yes, the engineers working in mission control were smart, often with military or other government agency experience helping their work. But to get humans from barely above the Earth to a 2-week mission landing on the moon appeared to be an almost impossible challenge. This would require a whole new thinking about mission control. Leading the way was Chris Kraft, who created Mission Control, and Bob Gilruth, who created the Manned Space Center, today's NASA Johnson Space Center in Houston. To get these systems ready quickly, efficiently, and safely might have prompted the cry, "Houston, we have a problem," more than a decade before the astronauts on the stricken Apollo 13 spacecraft uttered those words. But Gilruth, Kraft, and their employees, mostly made up of men in those days, were always solutions-oriented and fundamentally people of action. How did they set priorities? How did they resolve differences? How did they decide what to do when no one had done it before? Answering these questions took years of work, with some stumbles along the way. Ultimately, the goal was reached. The Apollo 11 astronauts landed safely on the moon within 6 months of Kennedy's deadline. But the path to the moon started inauspiciously on a 6-square-mile island off the coast of Virginia. Wallops Missile Development. As Gilruth recalled in a short memoir entitled, From Wallops Island to Project Mercury, most of the team building the Mercury program were veterans of the older National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, which was dissolved to make way for NASA. A key maturing process for the NACA engineers was operating a missile range at Wallops Island. Much of the early work at Wallops Island and in NACA was done in support of the ballistic missile program in the United States, Gilruth wrote. Had it not been for the ballistic missile development effort, we would not have had the knowledge of re-entry bodies, guidance systems, or other factors, such as launch rockets themselves, that were able to make possible manned flight in space in such a brief span of time after the space age arrived. They had some experience with technology, but there were also the leadership principles to consider. While missions were underway, senior leaders were building an organization, building infrastructure, and trying to invent the future, all at the same time. From its earliest days, NASA was committed to hiring the best. Fortunately, NASA had the funding and plenty of support in Congress, as everyone galvanized each other to beat the Russians in space. The space race was in full heat. Shepard had done a short suborbital flight into space, while the Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin had made 3 orbits and spent several hours in space. Yes, both men had been in this environment, but clearly Gagarin and the Soviets were ahead. The schedule pressures were almost overwhelming. All of our people worked holidays, evenings, and weekends. We even worked on New Year's Day, but we did take off New Year's Eve, Gilruth wrote. Those were days of the most intensive and dedicated work by a group of people that I have ever experienced. Gilruth also borrowed experts from other parts of government, particularly from the military. Both the Air Force and the Navy loaned flight surgeons to manage the health of the astronauts. Some of them had also participated in creating selection standards for the astronauts, and the famous Randolph Lovelace, who headed the Lovelace Clinic, where early astronaut selections took place, agreed to head an advisory committee studying space medical.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.